The biggest hack ever, Print Spooler, is an actual nightmare, and a hacker claims T-Mobile data was stolen in a server hack. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse and this is ThreatWire for August 17, 2021. This is your weekly summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. We have a bunch of hacks and 0 days to get into, so on to the news. Now last week, the Poly Network announced that they had been the victim of a cryptocurrency hack, wherein over $611 million in crypto was stolen and transferred to the attacker's digital wallet. The attackers reportedly gained access to Binance Chain, Ethereum, and Polygon assets. This makes it the biggest decentralized finance hack ever to occur. Now, Poly Network allows users to exchange tokens across different platforms like Bitcoin and Ethereum. In total, 273 million in Ethereum, 253 million in Binance Smart Chain, and 85 million in Polygon Network were stolen. Some tokens tied to this attack were also blacklisted. At the time of the hack, several theories arose, one being that the hack was due to a cryptography issue, and that problem sounds plausible, and eventually the vulnerability was determined. Poly Network did publicly announce how it happened, saying the problem lied in a vulnerability that concerns contract calls and is tied to a privileged contract called ETH Cross-Chain Manager. Now, tokens can be swapped between the blockchains using smart contracts, and those contracts have instructions saying when to release assets to counterparties. Poly Network's smart contract has lots of liquidity, so swapping tokens is really efficient, but the attacker was able to override the contract instructions for all three of the blockchains affected and divert those funds. Security firm SlowMist stated that they had also traced the attacker's ID. They found their email address, IP address, and device fingerprint, showing the attacker used Monero originally and exchanged it later for tokens used in the attack. Many networks that rely on Poly Network were also concerned that they would have to suspend operations, with one of those, O3, halting cross-chain features. On August 10th, Poly Network posted an open letter to the hacker to return the assets as they would be a target for law enforcement given the high amount of money stolen. The next day, Poly Network had recovered just $4.7 million of the $600 million stolen. Poly Network posted just a day after that that all remaining user assets had been transferred to a wallet controlled by both the hacker and Poly Network, with exception to some of the frozen tokens. According to reports, Poly Network offered a bug bounty payout of $500,000 to the attacker if they repaid the crypto. The attacker did an AMA online answering questions about this hack, saying that they had found a vulnerability and exposed it before somebody else could exploit it. Now, Poly Network called the perpetrator Mr. White Hat. While ethical hackers are sometimes nicknamed White Hats, this seems to fall short of a lot of those ethical standards, and the money is probably being given back due to difficulty laundering it or worry of being investigated and found by agencies. The attacker themselves asked how to use Tornado Cash, which allows for private Ethereum transactions. So my question for you is, was this an overzealous hacker who just wanted a quick cash grab? Or were they actually an ethical hacker looking to help Poly Network fix a bug? The entire story is really odd, but at least Poly Network recovered their funds. At least. The Windows Print Spooler is having a worst year ever, with the announcement back in June that a vulnerability in the Print Spooler could allow remote code execution and gaining of local system privileges. Now, this is tracked as CVE-2021-34527, and it's dubbed Print Nightmare. Microsoft fixed the remote code execution part of that problem, but soon after, researchers exploited the point and print feature in order to install malicious print drivers, allowing for privilege escalation. Now, along with this, another issue, which is tracked as CVE-2021-34481, could also allow for escalation of privileges. Microsoft addressed the issues with a Patch Tuesday update for August, which now requires users to have admin privileges to install printer drivers with that point and print feature. Users will not be able to install new printers using remotely available drivers unless they have admin privileges now. Now, a short time after this security patch went live, Microsoft had to issue another advisory for another bug. This one is tracked as CVE-2021-36958, and this one allows local attackers to get system privileges on a computer using the print spooler again. Researcher Benjamin Delpy called out this problem and the fact that it had not yet been fixed. In this case, if a driver already exists on a client device, connecting to a remote printer could execute copy file, and a malicious DLL could be copied and executed. Microsoft issued a warning and a workaround for this by disabling print spooler. This one was originally credited to Victor Mata of Fusion X, who disclosed this vulnerability in December of 2020. Now, we have learned that ransomware groups are also using these exploits to target Windows servers with Magnabur malware, as discovered by CrowdStrike. Now, a second group, which is called Vice Society, was discovered to be using Print Nightmare bugs as well, and this was according to Cisco Talos, and they are using this vulnerability in ransomware attacks. Because these flaws are now so well known and they are not completely patched, it's likely that other ransomware groups will join in on exploiting them in various ways, so your best course of action is to mitigate these issues as Microsoft recommends. I love it when y'all send in these adorable pictures of your pets, so these are a few from my Hush Puppy perk level patrons on Patreon and the Patreon Alliance. And also a big thank you to Aaron for joining this week. Patrons are starting to receive their new merch rewards in the mail, like mugs and stickers, depending on your perk level. Also, mad props to Gnome for sharing this awesome mugshot. This mugshot. Get it? You can always sign up at any time to get access to all of those perks. Patreon.com/ThreatWire, as always, for that. And on to the third news story. And another shout out goes out to Joel this week for sending this story my way. According to a report by Motherboard, an investigation is underway by T-Mobile to find out if a dark web forum post, which claims to be selling personal data from T-Mobile servers about their customers, is indeed real. The seller claims on this forum to have obtained data on over 100 million people from the carrier servers, including social security numbers, phone numbers, names, physical addresses, IMEI numbers for devices, and driver license information. The attacker claims the IMEI data is stolen and goes back to 2004. That's a really long time. Now, the seller wants 6 Bitcoin, which is about 270,000 USD in today's rates, for about 30 million of the SSNs and driver license numbers that they claim to have, while they are also selling the entire data set privately. Alan Gall, a CTO of Hudson Rock, which is a cybercrime intelligence firm, said the attacker did this in retaliation for the U.S., quote, kidnapping and torture of John Aaron Binz in Germany in 2019. They also did it to harm U.S. infrastructure. Now, while the forum post does not mention T-Mobile, the seller has told news outlets that this is indeed where the data came from. They claim the specified servers are T-Mobile's production, staging, and development servers, along with an Oracle database with customer data. T-Mobile has not commented further on the validity of these claims, and the seller did mention that they had lost access to the backdoored servers, though, but not before they had made backups of the data. So I am going to continue to follow this story closely. Now, I'm pretty excited if you missed last week's episode of ThreatWire, because my tech channel, which is youtube.com/ShannonMorse, just hit 60,000 subscribers, which is amazing. I still can't believe it. It just makes me feel amazing to know that y'all are really enjoying my content. I know a lot of y'all watch my security content over on that channel as well as over here, so thank you so much. You're awesome. And with that, do not forget to like and subscribe to this channel as well. I'm Shannon Morse, and I'll see you on the internet